control to increase the light. Various places like this hole, there's a lamp inside there that lit up the compass ring in the ceiling of the airplane.
Right.
There's a light here. You hung your watch in this little clip, so this lit up your watch for you. Okay.
So when you were shooting stars with this, was this part sticking out of the plane?
Oh, yeah. Above my hand here, this part stuck outside the airplane.
Okay.
Aircraft used to have a gigantic dome. It was like 3 feet wide.
Right.
And it was about like this high.
Yeah.
And you had to climb up in there and get your head and shoulders up inside there, and you held a smaller sextant.
Right.
And that was a big drag on the airplane. So when they went to higher speed airplanes, they wanted to eliminate that big plastic dome. So they devised this sextant. And only this part sticks out into the slipstream.
Okay.
So you can turn it. Now there's a prism here, and when you look through the eyepiece,
just on the other side,
you're looking through the sextant, and you turn this knob, and that makes this prism go up and down, mm-hmm. and so you can look at stars right on the horizon and all the way up, you know, above your head.
Mm-hmm.
So you could turn this prism, and that affected your vision, your image you were looking at through the eyepiece.
Pretty cool.
On the ceiling of the aircraft where this went through, there's a big ring with the compass graduations on it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Superimposed in your vision area is a little, this little lens shows that compass ring on the ceiling of the airplane.
Oh.
So as you turn this around, you'd be looking at different parts of that compass ring.
Okay.
That's how you knew which direction you were looking, north, south, whatever, outside of the airplane. So this special little thing is important to see that as part of your vision. Huh. I can draw you a picture of what it looks like to look through it and see a star and the bubble and the compass ring all lit up.
Oh, neat. Okay.
Now, typically, what you did, you ran a shot for 2 minutes. So if you computed a fix for 10 o'clock, you would start your sextant at 1:02. You'd observe the star for 2 minutes, which would be a minute before and a minute after the time of the shot, meaning the average period of time. So the star, the aircraft would wiggle around, and you constantly played with this knob to keep the star centered in your field of vision for that 2 minute period.
Right.
The start button here starts the timer. So the timer opened the lens and you could see the star, and then when you finished your 2 minute observation, it automatically put the shutter in front of your vision saying your shot's over, that's the end of your 2 minutes. So that was the start of the timer.
Okay.
Then when you got all done with your shot...
Wait, I hear it ticking.
Yeah, I started the timer.
Okay.
See, it's a mechanical winder. See the winding knob?
Oh, right.
Okay.
Yeah. Interesting.
Okay. Now, I'm going to show you these little indices over here. See these move?
Yep.
Okay. So you sight on your star, and as the aircraft wiggled or the star was rising or setting, you'd have to follow it. So as you turned this to follow the star, you'd keep the star in your center of vision. And at the end of the 2 minutes, then you return these two little things back to zero,
mm-hmm.
and then the reading on the dial was the height of the star for that average 2 minutes.
Okay.
You compared that with your calculations, and the difference is what you plotted on your chart in nautical miles.
Right. Interesting.
There's a cable connector for the lights.
Okay. What's this thing in the front? Turn it around. What's that thing?
What?
That's just the connector.
That's the electrical
cable.
Connection for a wire for the lights.
Okay. Huh. Fascinating. Okay.
Over here is filters. And if you're going to shoot the sun, you want to make damn certain that you had a dark filter in place. For stars, you didn't want any filters. You wanted just a clear vision, so you had a zero. But you had various degrees of darkness. So if you were going to look at the sun, you want the sun to be just a little orange dot.
Right.
And not a glare to burn a hole in your eyeball.
So you can shoot stars during the day, right?
Yeah, if a good bright star like Sirius or Venus and so forth. Mm-hmm. But you couldn't find them unless you had the calculations done in advance.
Right.
You put the information into the sextant saying Venus will be here this high. Mm-hmm. And then you put those figures in and you turn the sextant to that direction you want. Mm-hmm. And then when you open the shutter, the star would be pretty much in the center of your field of vision.
Okay, what is this bracket for?
That's where you hang your watch.
Oh.
This lit up your watch. So when you wanted to know what time to start your sextant, mm-hmm. like I say, you started at 1 minute prior to your calculated shot time.
Right.
And it ran 2 minutes.
Okay. Huh. And the Air Force issued you special watches, right?
No, it wasn't special. Well, it was it had a 24-hour face. It was really handy for that reason.
Okay. All right, cool.
Now, if the light on the compass ring was too bright in your field of vision, if you're shooting a very faint star,
right,
you could just throw this little lever, and that cut the light out of your field of vision. So this opened this lens.
Okay.
Just an extra. Then the bubble in the center of vision, ideally you wanted it about 3 times larger than the star. So this increased and decreased the size of that bubble.
Okay.
There's a very, very special trick. Nobody knows.
Oh.
The only way this bubble increase works
is
to tilt the sextant like this.
Really?
Yeah.
Before you put out the...
No, you could do it. You could tilt it pretty much like that when it was mounted.
Okay.
But yeah, that a lot of guys, like the guy who gave me this, had no idea what it worked, why the thing didn't work, because he turned the knob all day and the bubble size stayed the same.
Right.
So I told him that. He gave me the sextant free.